Well, good morning. I want to thank Kurt for inviting me here, and I want to thank Jennifer for all of the logistical work she's done to get this thing up and running. And I've enjoyed the conference so far. It's been really interesting to listen to what's going on. The thing I find fascinating is the fact that you guys are talking about how are you going to handle the warmer climate and the opportunities that you have as far as double cropping. And in California, we have a slightly different climate. And we've been triple cropping for some 20 years, 25 years now. I try to keep a crop in the ground every single day of the year if I can. With the day we harvest corn, we plant sedan grass and irrigate it up. So I think you guys will enjoy that. At any rate, California dreaming. Dreaming that dairy digesters are actually practical in California. My farm was established in 1914, we're in the middle of that Central Valley. If you saw Frank's presentation yesterday, that great big Central Valley of California, it's 100 miles wide and about 500 miles long. 25% of all the food consumed in the United States of America is produced in that valley. Virtually all of the dairy cows in California are in that valley as well. There's something like 1.5 million cows in California. We produce 20% of the nation's milk supply. There's only 1,400 dairymen in California with an average herd size of 1,200 cows or thereabouts. So we've got 1,500 milking cows, all registered Holsteins and a few Jerseys. We ship to Nestle, and then we also manufacture some of our own cheese. About 10% of the milk goes into our own cheese, and the other 90% goes to Nestle, which has a plant in Modesto. We have a closed herd. All replacements are housed on site. And we've got 530 total acres, of which we triple crop 460 acres. Irrigation is something that we rely on. We get absolutely zero rainfall from about the 15th of May until sometime in late August, September, sometimes October. So irrigation is an absolute necessity. I'm the third generation of Fiscalini's managing the farm, and my son is now managing. He's 30 years old and has a five-year-old son who is the fifth generation. We have affimeters, pedometers, and transponders. We breed our cows off affi heats. We milk three times a day. We have an energy-corrected milk at 28,000. Love BST, but we're not allowed to use it. We genomic test all females. We've been doing this for a couple of years now. We sell the bottom 25% of all females, so anything less than 200, whatever the number is for there. And our services per conception are relatively good at 2.5 or less. We established a cheese company in the year 2000. We make raw milk, artisanal, extraordinarily high quality, extraordinarily expensive to make cheeses. We make about 300 to 500,000 pounds of cheese a year and have $2 million plus dollars in gross sales. They're sold across the United States. We used to be in Wegmans some number of years ago, but California cheeses didn't do well in Wegmans, but we're in upscale cheese stores and wineries all across the United States. We're in some large stores. Occasionally we'll get into Costco or something like that, but typically we're in the higher priced cheeses, higher priced stores. And a typical store price is anywhere from $15 to $40 a pound. I don't get that kind of a price for it, so don't think that I'm walking on water here. All of our cheese is made in an open vat, very labor intensive. We use only milk from our own cows because we have plenty. We have really high quality milk. Nestle pays us a bonus for our milk. And one of the reasons why I managed to get the cheesemaker that I have on my farm is the fact that he saw the quality of our milk that we shipped to Nestle, and he thought he could work magic with that kind of milk because our cheeses are all raw milk. So we typically keep our raw count below 1,000, our pasteurized count below 100. Coliform bacteria below 10, which realistically is the same as pasteurized milk quality. So in theory, I suppose if we wanted to get into selling raw milk, we would be legal to do that, but that's not something I wish to endeavor into. Our bandage wrap cheddar is our signature cheese. It's my cheesemaker's extraordinarily, it's his specialty. It's made in a 60-pound wheel. It's won best traditional extra mature cheddar cheese in the world three times. We are the only non-UK company to ever have won that award, and we've done it 3 times. So we're pretty proud of that. Our second cheese is San Joaquin Gold. This is a picture of my cheesemaker, Mariana Gonzalez. It's made in a 30-pound wheel. It's won a number of gold medals nationally and internationally. And the third one is Leonza. This is our newer cheese. My family came from Switzerland. My wife and I and the cheesemaker and his wife went to Switzerland some number of years ago. I wanted to make a cheese that I thought my family had made. I know they are dairy farmers. The only thing they could have done in the winter high up in the Alps was make cheese, but I wanted this really sexy story about this this cheese has been passed down from generation to generation, written by hand, and I can't because that's not the truth. But we went to Leonza, Switzerland, and found a bunch of cheesemakers there that are all making exactly the same type of cheese. We assume my family must have made that since they live in the same area. So this is the cheese that we've made. It's a really nice cheese. And we also make a couple of different cheeses. We make a cheese called Purple Moon, which is a wine-soaked cheese. Horse Feathers, which is horseradish and cheddar cheese made into a spread. And Hopscotch, which is a beer-soaked cheese. So moving away from the cheese company back to the dairy, we have tried to be energy efficient and environmentally sensitive and profitable. We've done everything right except the last one. We have variable frequency drive motors on all of our wells, vacuum pumps, milk pumps. A couple of years ago, we installed LED lighting, which reduced the energy load quite a bit. We get hot water from our digester, so the majority of the heat, hot water we need for cleaning the dairy barn cheese plant come from theoretically free from a digester. We recycle chill water to feed cows, for cows for drinking, and then also for flush lanes. And then we're testing an acrylic coating on one of our freestall barns and the dairy parlor to see if we can reflect some of that sunlight off and cool cows a little bit better. And then, of course, we installed a digester in 2007 and 8, which we'll get into in a little bit more detail. My son just put in oscillating fans, and we're still testing those, but research now says you're supposed to have a set of fans over the freestalls and another set of fans over the feed bunk. So now that's two sets of fans where previously we only had one. The problem with putting fans over the freestalls, at least in our scenario, is these four-foot fans, no matter how high you put them and where you put them, the feed truck is going to bounce into them at some point in time, so you're going to have a train wreck. So we've put in these oscillating fans that are over the freestalls, and they move back and forth relatively slowly, but it seems to be working, and we're still testing these. Okay. Now we get into the big stuff, the dairy digester. And there is no pot of gold underneath this rainbow, let me tell you. We have two 860,000-gallon concrete tanks, 710 kilowatt Guascar V16 turbocharged biogas engine, 1,195 horsepower, I think. Our dairy is on a total flush system, so we use about 1.2 million gallons of water a day to flush all of the cows. We have two slope screen separators. We just changed that. It's ongoing right now. We're going to one, and we're putting in one of these roto digester machines that we didn't have to pay for, that someone else actually came in and put one in. We're testing it this week. And what's supposed to happen is all of the solid manure will go into this digester. They're going to take half of it and pay us for that half, and the other half is going to be used for bedding. And we'll see how that works. This is a solids feeder. When we first put the digester in, feed was somewhat cheap. And as I said, we triple cropped. So we actually took sedan grass silage, and we fed that into this hopper, and that augmented the amount of electricity we could make from the digester. As feed got higher priced, we decided that we couldn't afford to do that anymore. We needed the feed for the cows. So this kind of sits idle right now. We have a settling basin where all of this 1.2 million gallons of water a day come into a settling basin. We pump the solids off of that over the slope screen separator, and then what's left in the settling basin, what's left from that goes into the settling basin, and the solids and what's left, the small solids, which is still 80%, drops to the bottom and then gets pumped into the digester to make electricity. However, there are problems. As we were constructing our digester, we were told by two different agencies that the laws in California had just changed. And so we were the first people that were building a digester at the time that the California Air Board and Water Board had the authority to regulate what went on dairies. And of course, the digester was something that they wanted to regulate. So we have the Regional Water Quality Control Board and the San Joaquin Valley Air Pollution Control District. So the first thing the Air Board said was, the first thing they said was you can't put in an engine. You've got to put in a gas compression system and make pipeline quality gas, which we told them was impractical, and they said you have to prove it. So we called PG&E, and they said, well, there's no line anywhere close to you. It would cost about $1 million a mile to pipe this gas after you put in all of the gas scrubbing and whatever. So the Air Board eventually said, okay, you don't have to do that. Then they wanted us to put in another technology that was completely impractical. I can't even recall what that was at the moment. And eventually, after we got two or three companies to say this is completely impractical, they said, okay. So finally we put in the engine, but then they said you got to put in a catalytic converter. That cost $150,000. Had to install a flare, which we've never used, $50,000. We have to test the flare. Even though we don't use it, we still have to test it every 2 years. But the onerous thing that they did was they said our NOx levels had to be below 9 parts per million, and therefore we had to keep the H2S in our incoming gas into the engine had to be below 50 parts per million. And that is relatively impractical. And when we really tried to ask them, you know, why in the world are you telling me we have to achieve this low level? They said because we can't test the SOx that comes out of your engine. So the only way we can make sure that you are in compliance is to make sure that the amount of sulfur that goes into the engine is low enough that there won't be anything coming out. So they established this 50 ppm. Typical dairy digesters are 2 to 3,000 ppm. Ours is you know, roughly 300. You know, we've got a built-in H2S reduction system into the digester, one of these German technological things that I don't fully understand. But it, you know, it's about 300, which is not bad. And we've been fighting with them ever since 2007. We have had Air Board personnel on site and testing emissions on our digester at least once a week, 52 weeks a year, every single week since we built this thing. All of the information that they can take with their own sensing things that they bring out and spend an hour there, they can achieve online by logging into our digester data, but they choose not to do that or to test it because they think we're smart enough to be able to change that, I guess. And we have seen them leave their cars running with the air condition on when it's 105 degrees outside to test our engine for an hour. And we have a gentleman who installed the engine who one day went to these people and said, you know what, this engine produces less NOx than your Prius. And they said, we don't believe you. And he took out the appropriate testing devices and tested their car right there on the spot. And this engine produces less NOx than their Prius. So they come out to test this thing every week, drive 15 miles, and then leave the car running for an hour. And this is progress. The Water Board said that we couldn't bring in any outside material. And the whole design of this digester was to bring in off-site waste. So the Water Board required us to do a whole bunch of things before we could ever bring in off-site waste. It took about 4 years to be able to prove to them that it was a good idea. And by that time, I'd lost enough money. I was really getting tired of this thing. So the early results on this was the digester was over budget by at least 100%. The engine could only produce 300 kilowatts a day. You know, we put in a 710 kilowatt engine. We received 10.9 cents for our electricity. And early on, that was a penny more than what we were paying for it. And then we ran out of solids to use for bedding because of that hopper I showed you earlier. We were actually putting all of the solids into that hopper. And digesters do one thing really well. They reduce the amount of stuff that comes out of a dairy farm. We completely ran out of waste. Our H2S levels were excellent by most people's standard, less than 400 ppm. However, the parasitic load on a digester is relatively heavy, and on ours, where we have all these pumps running to pump water into the thing and back and forth, parasitic load's about 30% of the total revenue. We got no income from digested solids because we didn't even have enough to bed down the cows, but part of the ambiance of the people that installed our digester was the vast amount of money we were going to make from selling digested solids. But we've never had a violation either from the Air or Water Board. But the digester started losing money the day we had it up and running. So the middle results on this thing, we stopped feeding solids into the digester so we could have bedding. We petitioned the Water Board to bring in off-site waste, very costly. Finally managed to get that. Numerous meetings with the Air Board and the Water Board. And then we dropped down to about 150 kW because we no longer fed silage or solids into the digester. So we lost more money more rapidly than we had before. But we were finally capable of bringing in off-site waste. Then we realized how difficult it was to find good quality off-site waste, and the Water Board required us to test X number of loads that came in and in all kinds of testing of the effluent. So the last part of the puzzle here is we brought in an outside company to basically manage the digester. They are leasing the digester from me and just pay me a rental fee. We have received a bunch of grant money, and I want to thank Frank Mittlomer. Are you here today, Frank? Now, Frank has been instrumental in getting some of the results on this digester. But we've spent a lot of money. He finally came out. We had, close to $1 million grant. I mean, you talk about wasting taxpayer dollars. Had about $1 million grant to test the SOX that came out of this engine to prove that we didn't need to have our H2S below 50 parts per million. And Frank did that. And he proved to the Air Board that our SOX emissions were actually zero. And since he proved that to them, they, down at the bottom there, they required us to do one last test, another $15,000 to bring in an outside agency to prove what the $1 million grant already did prove. However, since that test, we have not seen the Air Board come out and test our engine anymore. That's been about 3 months now. So that's a good thing. When you don't have government on your property, that's a good thing. Sorry for those of you that are employed by the government. So now the digester. The good news is it's losing less money than ever before. But it's still losing money, and at the current model, it will never be profitable. It's going to take 20 years to pay this thing off with a loan I have at the bank. And it's not going to make money. So the bottom line, digesters are expensive to build. If you were to say, okay, everybody in the United States who has a dairy has to have a digester, it's not like solar or cell phones or whatever where you could say, okay, if we make 1,000 of these or 10,000, the cost is going to come down. This is all bricks and mortar. You know, the cost of a digester is going to be, the kind I built, it's going to be $2 to $3 million. And it can't get any cheaper than that. They're not easy to manage, especially when you bring in off-site waste. You need someone who is truly an engineer. The guys that are running our digester are chemical engineers. And then without government regulation, which I'm not a fan of, the utility companies can pay you whatever they want for the electricity coming out of a digester. So when we hear about all these wonderful stories in Europe, you know, the majority of the digesters in Europe are under some sort of government regulation where they're getting 30 cents, 25 cents a kilowatt, plus they're getting, they've mandated that you can't put digestible waste into landfills. So you know, we're charging, $10 a ton for waste to come into our facility. The guy that's managing my digester says in Europe they're getting $300 a ton. So you know, another revenue stream, which, you know, in order to make a digester profitable, at least in my opinion, these kind of things need to be done. It would be nice if companies would say we're going to do this out of the goodness of our heart, but they're probably not going to without a government mandate. But bottom line, though, is either way, you know, the consumer is going to be the one that's going to have to pay for this. For whatever reason, in California especially, solar and wind power are all government regulated at 20 cents or whatever a kilowatt, but digesters are not regulated. And I cut a pretty good deal to get 10 cents or almost 11 cents. I've heard of other people that are getting 4 and 5, and you can't make one of these things work. And then, of course, there's the agencies. You've got to have less government oversight. We have proven day after day with this thing that we're not polluting. But why does someone need to come out once a week and continue to try to prove that? It's just onerous. So what needs to be done? Co-digestion of off-site waste must be allowed if you're going to put a digester in. Tipping fees have to increase. Revenue must be at least equal to or better than solar and wind. And you've got to have trained digester operators. I thought, well, I'm a dairy farmer. I've got a college degree. I've got a degree in microbiology. I can manage this thing. I'm relatively smart. And it proved to me otherwise. Government agencies have to get out of the way. I mean, obviously, we have to have government agencies and whatever. We cannot be polluting and what have you. But nonetheless, there needs to be a greater degree of trust, I think, with the dairymen who are going to put these things in. And once I've achieved those, I'm going to balance the national budget. Thank you.